The great Church of Christ, for this holy metropolis, this parish and city, for every city and country, and for the faithful who live in them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who travel by land, sea, and air,
time I have listened to you, and helped you on the day of salvation. Behold, now is the acceptable time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. We put no obstacle in one's way, so that no fault may be found with our ministry. But as servants of God, we commend ourselves in every way, through great endurance, in afflictions, hardships, calamities, beatings, imprisonments, tumults, labors, watching, hunger, by purity, knowledge, forbearance, and kindness, the Holy Spirit, genuine love, truthful speech, and the power of God. With the weapons of righteousness for the right hand and for the left, in honor and in dishonor, in ill repute and in good repute, we are treated as impostors, yet are true, and as unknown, yet well known, and as dying, and behold, we live, as punished and yet not killed, as sorrowful, yet always rejoicing, as poor, yet making many rich, as having nothing, and yet possessing everything.
Peace be unto you, Lord.
And he gave it.
last few years. I could say, we need now. And that's a lesson in compassion. Because if, as a, I guess you could say, a non-biased person, as I am, the world has become compassionless. It truly has. For example, Father Theofani has a really high voice. And he doesn't have compassion on me. So he made me chant the gospel so high, I might not have a voice afterwards. I kid. We love Father Theofani. We request to have him as a brother as well. But in seriousness, we live in a compassionless society. We went from being places and being people that see people who are in need. For example, someone who's homeless. And you see this over time, where people used to look at someone who was homeless on the side of the road, and they would try to do something to assist them. Might give them money, might give them a bag of food or goodies or whatever it might be. To now, our minds straight going to, well, it's his fault, or it's her fault, they're homeless. It's not their fault. They can't control things in their lives. You can't control things in your lives. There are extenuating circumstances that you might not even know of. But at face value, our mind goes straight to, well, they must have done something to be in the position that they are now in. We become compassionate. We see people struggling, not just in homelessness. We see people who are addicted to drugs, for example. They must be doing something. It's their fault that they're addicted to drugs. Someone who deals with a mental health issue, such as anxiety or depression, we look at them and say, they must have done something to be anxious or depressed. It is their fault. We've become compassionate. In today's gospel, we hear that Christ had compassion. He went to a city called Nain, and he saw a funeral procession. There's nothing special about a funeral procession. Funerals happen every single day. So in our compassionate society, our mindset says, oh, someone died. Okay. What else? What else is new? Go to a cemetery. You see it every day. Because we become compassionate. Our hearts have become hardened. To be able to see somebody who is struggling, to see somebody who is experiencing, whether it's loss or might be in need of any type of compassion. And our minds go, you automatically did this, something you did that. Your health, what if it is? In today's society, they would have seen this funeral procession and they would have said, you want to know what? Kalanapati. He did something stupid. It's his fault that he died. Which means Kalanapati means that his action, something that doesn't get translated well. But, everyone's laughing back there. It doesn't translate well. But my AI used to say it all the time to me when I did something really stupid. Because I know, because we should have known better. So obviously because we did something stupid happened and it could have been avoided. That's the compassionateless part of it. A little bit humorous, but compassionateless. Because it's not people's fault for some of the struggles that they endure, but our minds straight go there because they must have done something. We've created a cause and effect system in our society. If they had just taken care of their health, they wouldn't die. If they didn't have these mental health issues that they chose to do, then they wouldn't be taking drugs. If they wouldn't be taking drugs, then they wouldn't be addicted. And it's just a whole, I guess you could say, snowball effect. But has anyone ever thought, just simply, this person's struggling. Let's be compassionate to them. Very simply, Christ sees a funeral procession. And he walks and sees what's happening. A mother who is a widow lost her only son. Now back then, if you were a woman and your husband had died, and then your sons have died, then quite literally you're cast out of the city. There's no one there to take care of you. Many people back then who were seen as outcasts, not just women, but even men, they resorted to any possible way to make money, and we're not going to go down the list of things that used to be done. But they used to basically be enslaved. Because they had no one to take care of them. So this person not only just lost his son, not only lost their husband, but is now going to be cast out of the city. Someone who has to work as a slave to have any level of protection. So yeah, she might be weeping because she's losing her son after just losing her husband, which is already enough loss. But now she's going to lose almost everything. And Christ sees this woman weeping, and here has compassion, and says to her, do not weep. And of course, resurrects her son, which is a powerful moment. Having that compassion changed this woman's life. Not just in regaining her son, but in regaining a status that wasn't going to allow her to be enslaved. It wasn't going to drastically change her life, even though it was already being drastically changed with the loss of her son. So when we think about how we can be compassionate, what that feeling might be like, we're going to look to the Greek. The word that is used to describe compassion comes from the same word, splachna is the word, and it means from your organs. When you think in levels of spirituality, it is defined as the innermost part of your body. So for example, when someone says, from the bottom of my heart, that's a good expression that kind of translates well into what I'm trying to describe to you. But when you see someone whom you love, for example, whether it be a family member, parents or children, children, your friends, grandparents, your grandchildren, your own children, and you see them struggling, your stomach churns. You feel this like just drop in your heart. That is compassion. It is important to know what that feeling feels like. Because that feeling should occur way more in your life. When you see someone out in the world struggling, when you see someone even within your own communities struggling, that feeling should occur more than once in a while. In truth, it should happen daily. Because unfortunately, people struggle every single day. Children, your friends, who might have a smile on their face, might be dealing with anxiety and depression. Ask questions. Parents, your children might be dealing with anxiety and depression. Ask questions. Feel for them. Don't get angry. Feel for them. People within our community, there are parishioners here who are struggling. Ask questions of how you can help and show compassion. Not because you are better, because you're not better. I'd rather be poor than have a hardened heart. I would rather be on the poor side of that struggle and have a compassionless heart. That's what I would rather. And that's what I challenge you all for, is just to look into the innermost part of your bodies and find compassion. The last couple of weeks within our community, we talked about love and how love in a very simple form is something that we can share with one another. It's how we can share God's presence in our life. Compassion goes hand in hand with that love. When you look at your brother and sister in Christ, and you see someone who's struggling, you should, because you love them, be compassionate with them, for them, and carry them and support them. Because that's the only way we're going to change the society that we live in. Because now, for example, and I I've said this time again, I'm going to use the same exact thing. You are merely just a peon in the world. And in St. Petersburg, where there's hundreds of thousands of people, you are merely just a peon, meaning someone really small. And that's a compliment. But when all of you are grouped together, all 80-something kids and their parents and all the parishioners here in St. Petersburg, we legitimately can change how Pinellas County is compassionate to its people. Because there's going to be around 200-300 people here today. In and out, in and out, in and out. And if we show compassion and love to each other, and then we take that same compassion and love that we hear about in the gospel, and that we experience within our church communities, and then we take that out to the world, you have no idea how much that changes people. And I'll give you an example of how that changes people. The people who were Gentiles, people who didn't really, they had different faiths, they were all over the place, they all saw this, they all witnessed not just the amazing miracle of someone resurrected from the dead, but they saw a complete stranger having compassion on someone, and in that moment witnessed the power of God being able to resurrect someone who passed away. And it isn't that fear seized them all. It was awe. Awe is the feeling that they had. So it wasn't fear, it was awe. They were in awe of God's power. They were in awe of Christ's compassion. They were in awe of that moment, in that action, completely changing this woman's world from losing her son to losing her status and having to be enslaved into a complete 180. And being someone who was restored, their son being fully present in their life, not having to be enslaved. And her, and along with all these other people, were in awe. And from that moment on, they knew they witnessed something special. They knew that they could say, in that moment, God has visited his people. It's because of that love. It's because of that compassion where these people came and gathered to see and saw that God has truly visited his people. So if you want God to visit St. Petersburg in Pinellas County, express love. Express compassion. Because God is love. God is compassion. And in those feelings that you have as a human being, as part of God's creation, God is within you. And you can also express those feelings so that you can truly yourself say that God has truly visited you. Amen. That ever guided by your mind, you may ascribe glory to you, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, both now and forever, to the ages of ages. Thank you.
Shame. Thank you.
Thank you.
ages of ages. Glory to our God, our hope, glory to you.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, both now and forever, and unto the ages of ages. Amen. Lord of mercy, Lord of mercy, Lord of mercy, Holy Father, bless.
May he who rose from the dead, Christ, which God, through the intercession of his all-pure, holy Immaculate Mother, of the holy, power, precious cross, of the intercession of the all-pure Immaculate, of the protection of the bodies, powers of heaven, of the supplication of the glorious prophet, for and John the Baptist, of the holy, glorious praise for the apostles, of the holy, glorious triumphant martyrs, of our righteous and God-bearing fathers, of St. Stephen, the proto-martyr and archdeacon, of the father among the saints, John Chrysostom, Archbishop of Constantinople, whose divine liturgy we celebrate, of the holy, righteous saints, Lord Joachim and Anna, and of all the saints, have mercy upon us and save us, for he is good and loves mankind. Through the prayers of the holy fathers, Lord Jesus Christ, our God, have mercy upon us and save us.
Take the knots, you say the Jesus prayer, Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy upon me, a sinner,
I want you to know that sometimes you get these things and they're manufactured basically by a machine. These are made by human beings. So they were made in prayer for you to use in prayer, not for you made in prayer for you to just leave on your wrist and forget about it. All right? These are them. These are for everyone. All right? So I've asked Father Theophani to bring them. He's got a whole bag and another bag. Well, let's get through this bag if we need to. All right? And then there's a little equipment as well, right? So he's going to be in the narthex, passing those out. All right? Andilorum will be up here. The blessed bread, which is for everyone that's here. Again, we're going to go from the sides, down the middle, and then please join us next door. May God bless you all. And have a wonderful week. She's at home, she's watching, so...